मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, लास्ट वीडियो वी वर डिस्कस्ड द डेफिनेशन ऑफ ईडीएलसी, व्हाट इज द पर्पस ऑफ ईडीएलसी एंड व्हाट आर द ऑब्जेक्टिव्स ऑफ ईडीएलसी. टुडे लेट्स सी द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक, डिफरेंट फेसेस ऑफ ईडीएलसी. द लाइफ साइकिल ऑफ योर प्रोडक्ट डेवलपमेंट इज कॉमनली रेफर्ड टू एज मॉडल्स. Model contains many phases. The number of phases in a model can vary depending on the complexity of the product under consideration. A simple product contains 5 phases. They are requirement analysis, design, development and testing, deployment and maintenance. The classic embedded product lifecycle model comprises 9 phases. They are need, conceptualization, analysis, design, development and testing, deployment, support, upgrade and retirement. Retirement also called as disposal. In a real world product development environment, the phases in this model may differ and sub-models may exist, or the models may only include key phases for the classic model. So the number of phases in the EDLC model is determined by the product complexity. So this is the first phase of EDLC, that is need. So in this phase, the team should discuss what is the need for this project, whether the need comes from an individual or from the public or from a company. Then prepare a statement of need or concept proposal. Senior management and the funding agency must review the concept proposal and it must receive the necessary approval. After the project has been approved, it is sent to a product development team, which may be an internal team or a third party product development or service business. The need for product creation can be visualized as one of the 3 needs mentioned below. The first one is new or custom product development. The need for a product that does not exist on the market or that competes with an existing product on the market can lead to the creation of a completely new product, that is new product or already available product, or if already available means who are the competitors. The product may be a commercial purpose or an individual requirement or a requirement of a particular organization. So these 2 points are considered in new or custom product development. The second one, product re-engineering. The process of making improvements to an existing product design and releasing it as a new version is known as re-engineering. It's commonly referred to as a product update. The following requirements are the necessary required re-engineering an existing product, that is change in business requirements, user interface enhancement, technology upgrades. So these points are considered while re-engineering, that is these are the requirements are necessary required re-engineering an existing product. The third one, product maintenance. The need for product maintenance is concerned with the providing technical support to end user with an existing product on the market. The repair request may be a result of a product malfunction or failure. There are 2 types of product maintenance. The first one, corrective maintenance, and second one is a preventive maintenance. Corrective maintenance is concerned with the corrective action taken as a result of a mistake or non-functioning. That means if the product is a failure or non-functioning, corrective maintenance should be carried out. Then the second one, that is a preventive maintenance. Preventive maintenance is a routine maintenance done to prevent a product from malfunctioning or breaking down. That is scheduling that is a scheduled maintenance should be taken for avoiding failure or non-functioning of the product. Then the next slide shows the conceptualization. So this is the second phase of the EDLC. The product design development phase is conceptualization, and it starts immediately after a concept plan is formally accepted. The conceptualization process determines the concept scope, conducts a cost-benefit analysis and feasibility studies, and prepare project management and risk management plans. Conceptualization can be viewed as a process that shapes the need of an end user or convinces the end user that is it is a feasible product and how this product can be realized. There are two types of practices in the conceptualization process, specifically the planning activity and the analysis and study activity. The analysis and study activities are performed to understand the opportunity of the product in the market. This is the another diagram of various activities involved in conceptualization phases. So the following are the main analysis and study activities carried out during the conceptualization phase. The first one, feasibility study. This study suggested one or more possible solutions along with alternatives. The second one, cost-benefit analysis. The cost-benefit analysis, that is CBA, is a method of determining, disclosing and evaluating the overall production cost and the estimated profit from the product. Popular unit of measurement, consumer preference-based benefit measurement and target end users are some of the fundamental concepts of cost-benefit analysis. Then third one, product scope. Product scope refers to what is included in the product scope and what is excluded. The scope of the product should be adequately recorded for future reference. Then fourth one, planning activities. So the planning activity includes a variety of plans necessary for the product creation, such as a plan and a schedule for implementing the next steps after conceptualization, then resource planning, risk management plan, and so on. The reports on the analysis and the study activities and planning activities are sent to the client or project sponsor for review and approval at the end of the conceptualization process, along with any of the following recommendations. The first recommendation, if the product is feasible, proceed to the next phase of the product life cycle. Second recommendation, if the product is not feasible, then scrap the project. So this is analysis. So this is the third phase of EDLC. The requirement analysis process begins immediately after the client or project sponsor approves the document. The documents are submitted during the conceptualization phase. Documentation related to user requirements from the conceptualization process is used as the foundation for further user need analysis and the creation of a detailed user requirements. The requirements review is carried out in order to create a comprehensive functional model of the product under consideration. During the requirements analysis phase, the product is described in detail in terms of inputs, process, outputs and interfaces on a functional level. The requirement analysis phase focuses on deciding what functions the product must perform rather than how to perform the how to perform those functions. Then the slide shows the various activities involved in requirement analysis phase. The following activities are carried out during the analysis phase. The first one, analysis and documentation. The second one, interface in definition and documentation. And third one, defining test plan and procedures. Let's see one by one. Analysis and documentation. the activity of research and documentation combines the business requirement of the product and the production and analyzes the product's function. Then it discusses the product's various functional aspect and quality attributes, determines the functional and data requirements, and link the functional and data requirements. So the following are the different criteria that must be discussed during the requirements review process for a product under consideration. The first one, functional capabilities like performance, operational characteristics, operational and non-operational quality attributes. Second one, product external interface requirements. Third one, data requirements. Fourth one, user manuals. Fifth one, operational requirements. Sixth one, maintenance requirements. Seventh one, general assumptions. Then the second one, interface definition and documentation. The interface definition and documentation activity should clearly analyze on the physical interface as well as data sharing through these interfaces and should document it. It is essential for the proper information flow throughout the life cycle. Then third one, that is estimating a test plan and procedures, identifies the accuracy of the samples as well as the coverage of the product testing. That is, define the testing methods, configuration and testing. It create a master test plan that covers both the functional and non-functional aspect of the product, as well as documenting the reach, process, sequence and management of all types of tests. It is critical for ensuring the product overall quality. The different methods of testing used in product development are as follows. First one, unit testing. Test each unit or module separately for required function and quality aspect. Integration testing is nothing but each module is integrated and the integrated test is integrated device is tested for necessary functionality. The third one, system testing. So after integration, assess the product functional aspect or product specifications. Usability testing, load testing, security testing, scalability testing, sanity testing, smoke testing, and performance testing and endurance testing are only a few examples of system testing. User acceptance testing, it is nothing but checking the product to see if it meets the user expectation. Then the slide shows the various activities involved in design phase. So this is the fourth phase of EDLC. The product design phase is concerned with the overall design of the product while keeping the specifications in mind, and it focuses on how the necessary functionalities can be presented to the product. The design process describes the application environment and develops the product overall architecture. So there are two product designs. The first one, preliminary design. Second one, detailed design. Let's see the preliminary design. It is also called as a high level design. This is the first step in creating a product. Preliminary design establishes the product top level architecture, list the various functional blocks needed and specifies the inputs and outputs for each functional block. So at this point in the design process, the functional block will appear as a black box with only the inputs and outputs of the black the inputs and outputs of the block identified. Okay. Then after completion, the preliminary design document, that is a PDD, is submitted for review to the end user or consumer who has established a need for the product. So if the end user approves the conceptual design, the project will be moved to the detailed design level. After completion, the preliminary design document PDD is submitted to the end user or customer who has identified a need for the product for review. If the end user approves the preliminary design, the product design team will move the project to the detailed design stage. In detailed design, it creates a detailed architecture by identifying and listing the different components for each functional block, then an interconnection between functional blocks, the control algorithm, specifications, and so on. The end user or client must also review and approve the detailed design. If the end user wants to modify the design team can be informed through review commands. Design of operations and maintenance manual and design of training materials are two other activities completed during the design process. The operation manual as well as the maintenance manual are required to inform the end user on how to use the product. So, the slide shows the preliminary design. So, in this, a large or different problem or difficult problem is divided into small problem or modules like module 1, module 2, module 3, etc. Each module has a separate inputs, a separate outputs, a separate constraints and assumptions. So, this is called as a preliminary design. Then, second one, that is a detailed design. So, in this separate modules like module 1, module 2, module 3, etc. are interconnected through the components C1 and C2, etc. Then verify the output after connecting all modules. So, this is called detailed design. Then, this slide shows the development and testing phase of EDLC. So, this is the fifth phase of EDLC. The development process turns the concept into a workable product. During the development process, various development tools are installed and configured, and the product hardware and firmware are designed using various tools and associated production setup. So, embedded hardware development, embedded firmware development and product enclosure development are examples of the development activities. The development of the component placement platform, that is a PCB using CAD tools and its fabrication using CAM tools is referred to as embedded hardware development. In second point, that is embedded firmware development is done with the aid of embedded firmware development software. Here, the embedded firmware development can be divided into modules, and the firmware analysis for each module as well as the systematic diagram and layout file review for hardware is performed during the development process, and any improvements that are needed should be integrated into the development on a regular basis. The testing process is divided into three parts, independent firmware and hardware testing of the product. After integrating the firmware and hardware, testing of the entire device on the functionality and non-functionality basis, and testing of the product against all acceptance requirements specified by the manufacturer. So, a test plan is created for unit testing, and test cases are defined to test the product functionality according to the design. Unit testing is usually done as part of the development process by the hardware or firmware manufacturer. Depending on the product's complexity, the remaining experiments can be considered tasks conducted during the product testing plan. After unit testing, the hardware and the software are integrated using different firmware integration techniques, and the integrated product is evaluated against the necessary functionalities. Integration testing ensures that the functionality evaluated in an associated mode, that is in an isolated mode, continues to operate properly. The integration test result are registered, and any bugs discovered during the testing are addressed in the firmware or hardware. The aim of the integration testing is to identify any differences between the firmware module units that are incorporated together, as well as between any of the firmware modules and the embedded hardware. Following integration testing, system testing is a set of different checks for functional and non-functional requirements verification. System testing is a form of a black box testing in which no knowledge of the product inner design, logic or code is required. System testing determines whether a product meets the criteria or not. So this is the fifth phase, that is a deployment. Deployment is the process of introducing the first fully functional model of a product to the market, or handing over the first fully functional model to an end user or customer. It is often referred to as first customer shipping, that is FCS. The deployment process begins after the device has been reviewed and approved by the end user. The following are the main tasks completed during the deployment process. The first one, notification of the product development. When the product is ready to launch in the market, it specifies of the launching ceremony should be conveyed to investors or customers, and whether it is a commercial product or general public. Then a notification may be sent via email, media and so on, mentioning the following in a few words. Okay, that is a deployment schedule. Deployment schedule is nothing but it contains a data, time and venue. Okay, that is a data, time and venue. Then a brief description about the product. Then targeted end users, support for additional functionality in relation to an existing product. Then product support information such as name of the support person, contact number, contact mail ID and so on. So this is about a notification of the product development. Then the second one, execution of a training plan. Here to familiarize the end user with the new product, proper training should be provided. Then third one, product installation. Install the product according to the installation instructions to ensure that is it is completely operating. Okay, then fourth one, product post implementation review. If the product has been released to the market, perform a post implementation analysis to determine the product's performance. Then the seventh slide shows the support. The support phases or the support process is concerned with the product's operation and maintenance in a manufacturing environment. During this process, all aspects of the product operation and maintenance are protected, and the product is scrutinized to ensure its quality, that it satisfies the end users or client. Then specifications, client specifications, okay, or client specifications. Bugs in the product can be found and detected during the operation phase. Then in order to fix any bugs in the product, support should be given to the end user or client. The support process ensures that the product meets the needs of the customer and continues to operate in the manufacturing environment. The following are the different tasks involved in the support phase. The first one, set up a dedicated support wing. Okay, that means a certain embedded product availability in terms of a product functioning in a manufacturing environment is critical, and they may need round the clock help in the event of the product failure or malfunction. Then second one, identify bugs and the area of improvement. There are bugs in all of the goods. Even if extreme caution is taken in the product design, production and implementation, bugs will exist, and bugs expose that true identify when condition favor them. Just a harmless microbes residing in a human body can transform into dangerous microbes when the body's resistance is poor. Then the eighth phase, that is upgrade. Eighth phase is upgrade. So the upgrade phase of a product production is concerned with the development of an upgrade for an existing product on the market. The end user requests significant bug fixes or feature enhancement, which result in a product updates. So during the upgrade process, the system can undergo design changes to address major bugs that have been identified, or to implement new feature addition specifications that have arisen during the support phase. Upgrades for embedded devices may be for the product's resident firmware or the hardware that embeds the firmware. Firmware upgrade is a method of quickly fixing bugs by changing the firmware. Some upgrades to features may also be beneficial. The resident firmware of the product will have a version number that starts with 1.0, and it is incremented after each firmware update or bug fix. Backward traceability requires the use of a version number. Update management oversees the distribution of updates. Hardware updates are used to describe such feature changes, the bug fixes that require hardware alteration. Firmware must also be updated to reflect the hardware upgrades. The updated product is sold under the same names as the original product, but with a different version number or a different name. The ninth phase is a retirement or disposal. Okay, the ninth phase is a retirement or disposal. a product cannot survive in the market for a long time due to increased consumer demand and disruptive technological changes. A product disposal or a retirement is a gradual process when a product manufacturer discovers that another powerful technology or component is available on the market that is better suited for the development of the current product. They will declare the current product obsolete and announces the introduction of a newer version or upgrade. So the retirement or disposition or process of a product creation life cycle is the point at which the product is deemed redundant and removed from the market. So there is no point in continuing to manufacture a computer or piece of equipment that is technologically and authentically absolute. Because of the following factors, a product disposition is critical. The first one is a rapid technology advancement. Second one, increased user needs. Some products will have a very long lifetime from the launching period to the retirement phase. And during this time, the product can gain a reasonable amount of maturity and consistency, and this will be able to create a sensational waves in the market. Some items have a shorter lifetime in the industry, while others struggle to make an appearance to all. We have now completed all phases of the embedded product development life cycle. The different phases of product development addressed so far can be linked to the different activities involved in our daily life. So far, we have discussed the different phases of EDLC, that is a need, conceptualization, analysis, design, development and testing, deployment, support, upgrade and retirement. So the remaining topics we will see in the next video. Thank you.